Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
One of the things that Yeshua taught on over and over and over was the reality of the kingdom. And now we're ready for Revelation chapter 20. And what are we going to study? The millennial kingdom. Now, the first thing that we need to understand about the kingdom of God is that there are stages. First comes a millennial kingdom. But before we talk about the character of that millennial kingdom, what life is going to be like, who's going to be there, what is their experience going to be, we need to realize that Messiah Yeshua comes prior to the establishment of that kingdom. Because it's a millennial kingdom, we talk about the pre-millennial return of Messiah. So anyone that points to the kingdom and speaks of it not as a pre-millennial return of Messiah, they have it wrong. Secondly, there's more and more people that say, well, what Revelation 20 talks about, a millennial kingdom? That's now. That's not the case. Or there is no millennial kingdom. We just go into the kingdom in its very fullness. That's not correct either. If order for us to have a right understanding prophetically of the things of God and to understand who we are in Messiah and what ultimately God's going to bring about, we need to have a proper understanding of this millennial kingdom. Why this kingdom is on earth in Jerusalem, the Jerusalem of today is going to be very different, but why it's there and what we need to derive and understand from that reality. So if that's it, take out your Bible and look with me to Revelation chapter 20 and verse 1. Messiah has returned on that white horse. He has come with his armies. He has defeated that false prophet, that beast, that harlot, and all those who have been part of that kingdom, that empire. And now there's a new reality. Look, if you would, to verse 1. I looked, and an angel came down from the heavens, and in his hand was the key to the bottomless pit or abyss and a great chain. And what is he going to do? Well, it says in verse 2, and he seizes that dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil, who is Satan, and he binds him there for 1,000 years. Now, one of the first things that we can learn about the millennial kingdom is that Satan is bound for that 1,000 years. Now, those individuals that talk that we're living in the millennial kingdom, they spiritualize things so very much. It empties the scripture of much of their relevance. And when you apply that methodology to the scripture, it really empties out so much of what the scripture wants to reveal. So the first thing that we learn is that Satan is bound under the world in the abyss for 1,000 years. That means to tell us he's not going to have any influence. The only influence that's going to be present in the millennial kingdom is the influence of Messiah Yeshua and his word that is going to go out and how we call are called to respond to it. So look again. This dragon, this devil, this serpent of old, he is going to be seized and bound there for 1,000 years. Look at verse 3. And he was cast there in the abyss. He was closed up, and a seal was placed upon him on account that he should not. And one of the things we find concerning the devil, Satan, that serpent, is over and over he is seen here as a deceiver. And one of the ways that he deceives is that he calls doubt to everything that God says. So when we encounter something in the scripture and we doubt it, understand that we're falling right into the predicament of what Satan wants. When we begin to doubt, we are weakened spiritually. We are entering into a place where the enemy has control over us. Doubt is a dangerous thing. So he's going to be bound for those 1,000 years where he can no longer deceive the nations. And at the end of 1,000 years, notice what it says. It says, and afterwards, it is necessary that he be released for a short time. Now, we have to ask ourselves, why? I mean, a good place for Satan to be is bound in this abyss. So why is it necessary? And that word there that appears in the biblical language means it is absolutely necessary. Well, to answer that question, we have to answer first, who's part of the millennial kingdom? And we're going to see, biblically speaking, there are a few groups that inhabit the millennial kingdom. The first one are those who took part in the rapture. Now, we talked about the fact that the rapture happens shortly thereafter. No man knows the day or the hour, but shortly after the abomination of desolation. One of the outcomes of the rapture is every believer, whether they are alive or whether they have already died, every believer is going to receive a glorified body. And they are going to be in the heavens until the return, that is the second coming of Messiah. So the first group that's there is the body of believers. It makes no difference whether they are Jew or Gentile. Every believer, from whatever language they speak, whatever tribe they may be from whatever ethnicity they are found within, every believer is going to be part of that first group of all the various ages. All those who came to faith prior to the rapture. Now, the second group are going to be those who come to faith after the rapture who are Jewish. One of the things we know is that the scripture, we talked about this when we studied the book of Zechariah, when it speaks about the second coming of Messiah, we know one of the places he's coming to is the Mount of Olives. That is, he's coming to Israel. And it says that they are going to look upon the one who is pierced, and they're going to mourn, that is a form of worship. They're going to receive him. So there's going to be a group of Jewish individuals who come to faith at the return, the second coming, not at the rapture, but at the second coming, or after rapture up to that time. And they also are going to be in the millennial kingdom. There's also, and here's the third group, there's also going to be Gentiles, non-Jews, who do indeed come to faith after the rapture, but before the millennial kingdom. So let's review. On day one of the millennial kingdom, day one of those 1,000 years, every individual that's there is a believer. Whether they took part in the rapture or whether they came to faith after the rapture, they are all saved, everyone on day one. But there's a difference. One of the things we need to remember is every believer that took part in the rapture, what did they receive? They received a glorified, a holy, a kingdom body. And because of that, we know that they will not be able to procreate. They're not going to have offspring. The second thing we need to realize is that those who come to faith of Israel and also of the nations after the rapture, they're going to be saved, but there's no evidence in the scripture, there's no place where it says that they're going to receive a glorified body, and there's a reason for that. Whereas the first group, those in the rapture, those who have a new body, where they cannot procreate, the ones who came to faith after, of both Jew and Gentile, they will be able to do so. Now, I've shared with you that when we look at places like Isaiah chapter 2 or Micah chapter 4, we find that when it speaks there of the kingdom of God, that is the millennial kingdom, it says that the law will go forth from Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. What is that a reference to? The law, the commandments, the word of God. And one of the first commandments we see in the Torah is to be fruitful and multiply. So because the Torah is the rule of law in the millennial kingdom, we find that people are going to be fruitful. They're going to multiply. And that brings us to the fourth group of people. Remember the first one, Jews and Gentiles that came to faith prior to the rapture, those who have a glorified body. The second group, those of Jewish descent that came to faith after the rapture, but before the millennial kingdom, they're going to be believers. They'll be there, but in a regular body. And likewise, there's going to be the third group, the Gentiles, who come to faith after the rapture, but before the millennial kingdom is established. They're going to be there, but they're not going to have a glorified body. So groups 2 and 3 are going to procreate, and that brings us to the fourth group. And this fourth group is very important. Now remember, the commandment is to be fruitful and multiply. So this millennial kingdom, it is going to grow. There is going to be an abundance of those who are in the fourth group. Remember, those people who are there of the second and third group, even though they do not have a glorified body, the scripture tells us that people are going to live in an abundant amount of time. They're going to procreate for many, many years. And therefore, during those 1,000 years, the fourth group will become the largest. Now, why is that important? Well, let's go back to the text. We know that during those 1,000 years, Messiah is going to rule. We saw in Revelation chapter 19, he is going to rule with the rod of iron. We know that he's going to rule from the temple, a new temple in Jerusalem. And he's going to rule according to the word of God, that is, the laws of God, the commandments of God, the Torah, as we saw. The law will go forth from Zion, and Zion is a word that is used in reference to this millennial kingdom. So everything during those 1,000 years is going to be administered. It's going to be a kingdom of righteousness, godly rule. And what happens? Well, notice what we saw in the verse 3. At the end of the 1,000 years, we find that Satan is going to be released for a short time. Now, why is that? Well, keep reading verse 4. And I looked, and I saw the thrones and those who sat upon them, and judgment was given into them, and the souls that were killed for the testimony of Yeshua and for the word of God. Here again, do you see the connection? Those who embrace the word of God, what did they do? They manifest the testimony of Messiah Yeshua. It says, those who did not worship the beast or the image and did not receive the mark of the beast upon their forehead or upon their hand. It says, and they were raised up and they lived and they ruled with Messiah for those 1,000 years. So this is a reference to those believers. What are we going to do? Well, it says here, we're going to rule and reign with Messiah for those 1,000 years. Who? Those who have the testimony of Messiah. And at the end, look at it now at verse 5. And the rest of the dead, they did not rise to life. Remember, everyone rises to life. What we talked about a few weeks ago in Daniel chapter 12, where it says, everyone is going to rise from the dead, some to everlasting life, and some to everlasting death and contempt. So this second group, they're not going to be part of the millennial kingdom. They have been cast into death, that is, into punishment with the beast, with the false prophet. That's who we're talking about now. That group, it says, the rest of the dead, they are not going to rise and live until the end of 1,000 years. So once again, there's been 2 mentions about what happens at the end of the 1,000 years. We find that Satan has to be released, and we find that there's going to be another resurrection. Let's move on. We find in verse 5 once more, and the rest of the dead, they did not live and rise until the end of 1,000 years. For this is the first resurrection. What is? Those who take part in the millennial kingdom. Verse 6. Blessed is the man, and holy is he, who has his portion in the first resurrection. He says, of these, the second death won't have any authority or power over him. For they shall be priests of God and his Messiah, and they will rule with him for 1,000 years. Now, let me just deal with one theological issue. This is the second time we've seen a reference to those who will rule with Messiah. The first time it talks about those who suffered because of the testimony of Yeshua and were put to death during the rule of the Antichrist. Those who did not take their mark of the beast upon their head or forehead or hand. Here, the second time, it speaks in a general sense. So what I want you to see is those who are going to be ruling and reigning with Messiah are those who were faithful, who have received Messiah prior to the rapture. Now, let's move on. We see something very important in verse 7. And after the 1,000 years, Satan, he was released from his prison. And this is the passage that is so difficult for people to see. Why would Satan be released? As I said, isn't it a good thing that he's in that abyss, in that bottomless pit? Of course it is. So why would God say it is necessary to release him? Here's one of the best texts that asserts the doctrine of free will. Those individuals who were born, remember that fourth group, an abundant group, a large group, born during the millennial kingdom. Now that's going to be a new and a different dispensation. Why do I say that? Well, if I were to ask you right now, do you believe in Yeshua? If you answered yes, what you're saying is, I have faith in him. And faith is the substance of things hoped for but yet not seen. So that causes a very unique situation. In the millennial kingdom, that question, do you have faith in Yeshua, is very, very different. Because if we learn that faith is what we hope for but we have not seen during the millennial kingdom, you'll be able to see Yeshua. He is ruling, remember, with that rod of iron. He is ruling in Jerusalem from the throne of God. And his rule is absolute. If you sin, there's going to be a consequence. And the way that people, don't miss this, the way that people of that fourth group manifest their faith, that is, their trust in God, is if they should sin, what do? They offer up a sacrifice. Now here again, this causes problems in many people's theology, but it shouldn't if you understand it properly. Let me give an example. Biblically speaking, we know something. We know that all the sacrifices that took place, whether it's the patriarchs, whether it was the sacrifices in the wilderness, in the tabernacle, whether the ones in Shiloh at the tabernacle there, or ultimately in Jerusalem at the temple there, all those sacrifices point to something. What is that? They point to the cross, the all-sufficient sacrifice, once and for all, complete, lacking nothing. They all point towards that. Now, what scholars teach is this. All the sacrifices in the millennial kingdom, they in and of themselves don't atone. What they do, the same thing as all the ones prior to Messiah, whereby those pointed forward to Messiah's cross. What the ones do in the millennial kingdom is that they point backwards to the cross. So what atones for sins? What brings about real forgiveness? The answer is the sacrifice of Messiah, all sufficient once and for all. But nevertheless, to demonstrate that faith in Messiah, what do they have to do? They have to go and obey the Torah sacrifices as a testimony, as an act in faith. So during those 1,000 years, we're going to see Messiah. He rules with that rod of iron. He is going to enforce righteousness. Justice is going to be maintained and mediated out immediately. So there's going to be 1,000 years of God's righteous rule through his Mashiach, his anointed one, his Christ. Now think about it. If you were not born here in this world, what's this world like? This world is full of injustice. This world is full of corruption. Not so in the millennial kingdom. Those people of the fourth group, they are going to be born and live throughout their entire existence in a kingdom of righteousness and justice. Laws are going to be enforced. Things are going to be fair. And what happens? Well, all those people, because they were forced to live under that, they haven't had the opportunity to exercise free will in regard to Messiah. Right now, if they sin, He punishes. He puts pressure on them in order to do the right thing. But what happens? Well, look again at verse 7. And after the completion of the 1,000 years, Satan is released from his prison. And what does he do? Look at verse 8. What does Satan always do? He is the father of lies. He masquerades as an angel of light when he's from darkness. What does it say in the book of Revelation that the Satan and the devil and that serpent of old does over and over? Deceives, deceives, deceives. And he's going to continue to deceive. Now, why must that be? The answer is because of the doctrine of free will. Yes, God is sovereign, but He in His providence, He in His omniscience realize that without free will, there can't be love. Because love involves a choice. Love involves a sacrifice. So what's going to happen is this. Satan is going to be revealed or released. He is going to go and deceive. What's his message of deception? We derive this from the text. He says, you come out of that holy place. You don't want to be in that holy place, do you? You don't want to live under God's justice. You don't want to be in righteousness, do you? And what's he going to do is say, you come out and join me. And what we'll do is we'll assemble, we'll become a great army, and then we'll come back and we'll destroy the camp of the saints, and we'll overcome this Lamb, this King of Kings, this Lord of Lords, and we'll start it our way. That's what he promises. Why do I say that? Well, look, if you would, to verse 8. He goes out and he deceives who? The nations. Now, that word again reveals those who have no covenantal relationship with God. Now, you enter into a covenant how? By free will. You choose to enter into covenant. These people, they didn't. It says that these are those without a covenant, and he takes them out into the four corners of the earth to Gog and Magog. Now, here again, people look at that and say, well, I'm confused because Gog and Magog, that's in Ezekiel 38 and 39. I thought that already happened. It did happen. What does John do? What is the style of John's inspiration? He takes well-known things from the Hebrew Scriptures, from the Tanakh, the Old Testament, and he brings them into the book of Revelation, whereby he puts them in their original context, but in a different situation. What do we know about the battle Gog and Magog? One thing, we win. That is, God's covenant people win. It is deliverance for the children of Israel. What's the children of Israel? One way that we can understand that is not just those of physical descent, more important than that. Remember what Paul says in the book of Romans chapter 9 and verse 6, not all of those of Israel is of Israel. Meaning not everyone from the loins of Jacob is going to be part of Israel. What's Israel in the second use? The kingdom people. So what we find in this passage is Satan goes forth and he says, we're going to have a battle. But the Word of God says this battle is Gog and Magog, not the one of Ezekiel 38, 39. It brings us that term Gog and Magog. Why? Because God's covenantal people were victorious. God's kingdom people are going to be victorious. And that's why we read, once again, verse 8. He goes out and deceives the nations on the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog. That is, we're going to be victorious. And they gather together for war, and the number is like the sand on the seashore. Now, if you were to ask me, what is one of the things that surprise you most in the Scripture? I would say this verse, but just what we read. How can it be this great multitude, a number like the sand upon the seashore? How is it possible after living in a kingdom of justice and righteousness where God's mercy is manifested, His perfect rule? How is it that there is such a large number of people who are going to be deceived and who don't want to live in that kingdom, who want to rebel against it? That just shows you about how that evil inclination, if we don't bring ourselves under and submit to the grace of God, if we don't respond to that invitation, if we don't exercise free will, if we don't, we have no hope in and of ourselves to be able to find the right, the kingdom, the goodness that God wants us to receive. So once more, this number is without number. It is like the sand upon the seashore. Verse 9, and they go up upon the breast of the earth. They surround the camp of who? The saints. And the city which is beloved by God. Now, there's this great multitude, and they're coming to Jerusalem, the beloved city, the encampment of the saints. And now we're going to find that there's going to be this great war, right? No. This is so anticlimactic. Why do I say that? Because if you see what happens at the end, it's just in a moment. This is not the battle of Gog and Magog. Everything about it's different. Gog and Magog is just to foreshadow, to teach us there's going to be victory. What happens? Well, let's read it. Middle of verse 9. And fire comes down from God, from the heavens, and consumes them. Victory. He consumes them in a fraction of a second. Justice is maintained. God's judgment is seen prior to what? The final expression of the kingdom of God. And that's what we're going to talk about next week as we press on in Revelation in chapter 20.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.